These guys started a car company at home in their garage. Well, not exactly.
That's it.
But they did build this self-driving car in about 100 days.
Oh, shit. Oh, my God. Brakes work.
And if that wasn't enough, now they're building a flying ATV.
It's dangerous, so, like, how do we not chop our hands off? How do we make sure this thing doesn't fly away?
And you won't believe what hidden technology makes this all possible.
What will it be like when people realize that there's no technology barriers holding them back from whatever they want to create? We need to go back to the beginning where we started in our garage and we created something that literally changed the world.
Why do this?
Well, because you can, of course. But this is just one example of a step change in the level of industry that can happen at home. And it's part of a social change you might not have noticed.
Now we have Amazon and we have YouTube. And with those two tools, you can order any part you need within 2 days and then find a video with all the information you could ever need. Like, that's kind of what America was built on, where anybody can prosper if they try. And now we're just at the next level of that.
Come meet the folks behind NiFT, an engineering company that takes audacious ideas and makes them real. So are you ready for the real industrial revolution? This is Hard Reset, a series about rebuilding our world from scratch. This is Shane Elwert, former Ford engineer. Allegedly, he also worked as David Harbour's stunt double for a while.
Yep.
No, I made that up, but really, look, I'm not crazy, right? Anyway, this all started because Shane, like the rest of us, decided he needed to keep busy during the pandemic.
My wife said, well, was there something like that you could do that you were doing? I was working for a company that brings in $100 billion a year. I don't have the resources to do anything that they're doing. But then I started thinking about it and I'm like, well, maybe we could do something.
Some people would have learned to knit or adopted a puppy, maybe redecorated a bedroom. Shane decided to build a self-driving car.
The goal was to demonstrate a driverless shuttle that we built in our garage in a time frame that's sort of ridiculous and create something that's like, hey, you know, your $1 million vehicle, mine starts at $20,000.
With the help of family and friends, Shane and his kids, and he has a few kids, worked for 100 days to make this self-driving car into a reality. And yeah, it's real and it works. So how'd they do it?
First of all, what are some high-level requirements? We're going to make it electric. Okay. It's going to be driverless without traditional driver controls. And then you take those high-level things and you just keep breaking them down.
And so we designed it on a golf cart chassis because they're super cheap, super simple. My younger brother came up with the shape of the shuttle, and it's pretty much what the original like napkin sketch looked like.
It took us 9 days to get us to be able to actually drive. Go for a ride?
You just gotta go light on the steering, dude. Just go light, go light.
And then we wanted something that could possibly be flat packed. So that's where all the Lexan and plywood came from. My uncle has access to a CNC, so we used that. We knew how to weld. That was kind of like our design process, was use the things that we have and then go from there.
We got brakes, we got turn signals, we got side markers. And this is here so I don't cut my head. I've cut it like several times already.
Some of the hardest parts that I ran into was to figure out how to connect our computer that we're using to an Xbox controller and then back to the motors and control it through a computer rather than through a physical steering wheel.
Today is our first test of auto braking. We got a friend here. He's gonna be our test dummy.
Ah, you killed it.
Throttle, full throttle!
No gas, no brake.
I think the hardest thing on the project probably is the autonomy part of it. The initial thing we did was basically track the edge of the curb and drive based on where the curb is.
I think on the mental and emotional side of things, hey, I don't have a job here and I'm making this stupid thing. Why on earth am I doing this? Those things I think are very difficult to deal with, and the engineering problems are fun compared to that.
It would be a mistake to think that this project was easy or cheap. Shane's an engineer with decades of experience, and his kids have tons of experience too. But still, the idea that you could build something like a self-driving car at home would have been unthinkable just 10 years ago.
With 3D printers or like Arduinos, like those things are so accessible now, they just work out of the box basically. And it's honestly insanely easy now, just because there's so much information if you're able to use it.
Everything we did was very, very low cost. This is like a giant tool chest that just came out of nowhere in the last 20 years. And there's more coming.
But there's another technology that made this all possible. It's an invisible technology. And it's actually been staring you in the face for most of this episode. You might be familiar with it. It's called a garage. You probably don't think of a garage as a technology, but it is. And it's a relatively new one, originating in the early 20th century. As more people owned cars and needed a place to keep them secure, the garage became a common fixture in our homes. But the garage, like so many other technologies, became much more than just what it was intended to be. It's a big open space, freed from the obligations and social conventions that shape what we do in all the other rooms of our house. It's a blank slate, right in our homes, and that invites us to build or create things.
The garage is like basically, or at least the way we use it, it's like just a creative space. It's just a place to go build things and try new things. Like, why would you put your car in the garage?
I'm here because this is what I love doing. And when I came out of school and ended up with a desk job, I was just like, I actually want to be in the garage making something.
Of course, not everything needs a garage. Facebook was started in a dorm room. Microsoft started in a motel room. But those were software startups. Some things need more space, and that's where the garage comes in. Things like starting a band, or an animation studio, or a shoe company, or a computer company, or a fruit company, or now an autonomous car company.
Computer, take me to the bridge.
I generally move it around with the Xbox controller, even when you're not using it autonomously.
Right.
You have to be able to steer it somehow.
So. Right.
I'm gonna let you drive, man.
Oh, all right, cool.
I'll man the safety switch. So.
All right.
I'll just give you a little instruction.
How do I fire tortoiseshells?
I was able to take the shuttle for a spin. The autonomous mode is currently restricted to following the path of a curb. And since there are no curbs in their office park, I had to pilot it with this Xbox controller. Luckily, I am an amazing driver, and Shane was not nervous or terrified at all.
No, you're good. The steering is very... I just wanted to make sure that was you.
Okay, so the steering takes a little getting used to.
You want to go nice and slow.
I mean, I'm just going to say it. Hey, you're right next to a freeway.
After the car was finished, Shane started NiFT. They pivoted from building shuttles, and now they help other people bring their designs into reality.
Sometimes an organization can only go as far as the box allows them to go, and then they get squished back in. You need the smaller companies to actually provide some creative outlet. And I kind of feel like that's what NiFT is, that's what I am. You're like a multi-tool.
One of the cool things is just like, so we built the shuttle, and people see that we can build a full vehicle. It's opened up some doors for us to do like full vehicle prototyping for people.
They work with car companies to build prototypes and test new technologies. Things like this modular battery system for EVs and this electric supercar.
So what people do, they just squat by the car.
But so we did cooling, electrical high voltage, electrical low voltage. That's our part, is just getting the vehicle to go from a chassis with a motor and inverter in it to a fully functional electric vehicle.
It's amazing. I mean, it's a really interesting set of challenges. I mean, there's things I don't miss, but I mean, like, they don't make cars like this anymore. This is a beautiful, beautifully designed car.
So we got to bring them up to date with the 21st century. So first, you know, just watch Back to the Future. You know, we'll get the end story. You first convert it to electric, second you convert it to autonomous, and then third you make it fly.
Right. That's basically the NiFT story.
And then,
which brings us to their next personal project. Because they weren't satisfied with just building a self-driving car, Shane and company are now building a flying ATV, or a VTV, if you will. Basically, it's a drone you can ride. What could go wrong? Hey, right now is an amazing time for innovators to bring great products to the market. You don't need to wait for the big companies to make the product that you want to see in the world. You can make it yourself. And our sponsor for this episode is a perfect example of that. These are the Everyday Earbuds from Raycon. I love them. They're easy to use and comfortable to wear. They work seamlessly with all my devices and have really great sound quality. They even have cool covers, like this one, which looks like space, because I want to go to there. They charge wirelessly and fast, and they have 32 hours of battery life. But my favorite feature is that I can actually have them connected to two devices simultaneously. That means I can be listening to an audiobook on my phone, but when I jump into a meeting on my computer, it just switches automatically. They also have really impressive noise cancellation, which I tested against Interstate 280.
And they're not constantly falling out of my ears like some other wireless headsets I could hint at, that fall out when I'm walking or turning my head or literally just sitting there. Anyway, this is a perfect hard reset sponsor because the product is good and the price is affordable. And yes, it is true that they are paying us money, but we really do like the product. So if you've been looking for a way to support our show, buy these everyday earbuds and watch all of our hard reset YouTube videos with them. Maybe watch them twice. Click the link in the description box below or go to buyraycon.com/freething to get 15% off your Raycon purchase plus free shipping. Okay, sponsored section over, back to the episode.
This is what we call Fourth Dimension by NiFT, and this here is intended to be a single passenger ultralight vehicle. Doesn't require a pilot's license. We'll have some basic functions like auto landing, height control, and so forth.
And this is a half scale model, so it would be twice as long, twice as wide, twice as tall.
Yep. One of the main goals is actually to basically get the blades away from people and other things. You know, if you were to get in an accident with a bladed vehicle,
right?
You know, you have shrapnel, and then you also have, you know, imminent, you know, destruction following.
It's a lot of spinning knives.
So we just decided to, why don't we start with half scale? That'll keep us from trying to get into it and doing something stupid.
And so the idea here is that instead of having those big rotors like we see in a lot of other eVTOL things, you would have some other mechanism here that pulls the air in from the sides and shoots it down. So,
yeah.
This is early days for this project, but we got to see their half-scale prototype as they did an early test of their propulsion system.
It's not going to lift off the ground, but it'll sound cool.
So we're at 40% thrust. 40%. There's only 5% of the motors.
Right.
40% thrust, we probably have about 15 pounds of thrust right there that we're just blowing around just for fun.
Right. So the next stage of this, right now you're running this tethered.
Yeah.
So at some point, this kind of battery pack would need to be, would you be able to use something this heavy
We won't use these cells. We're targeting an 80-pound battery.
Okay.
It's going to be about 15 minutes of flight time, but we have a lot before we could even get close to that.
Wow, that's super cool.
But things look promising. Their earlier test flights were able to get liftoff with the skeleton of the VTV.
It's pretty amazing. A little scary because the first time we tested it, we hadn't tuned it yet, so it was just flying all around and it was a little dangerous.
Very chaotic.
So, and then once we actually were able to take it off the ropes and float it by itself, it was very, very cool to see, seeing something this big floating.
A project like this makes it clear that we're in the middle of a pretty incredible moment of change. An accident of architecture, the explosion of cheap hardware, and new outlets like YouTube that make it easy for anyone to learn how to put things together, these are all colliding right now.
Nowadays, just a single guy in his garage can make videos about it, and you know, millions of people can see those videos and be impacted and inspired to go do great things with that.
Ideas can come from small places, all these people starting things in garages. If you can get the idea out there, like build a prototype, you can actually succeed and build a company. Like you can bring a new product to market.
This is the beginning of the real industrial revolution. The emphasis here is on revolution, because things are turned upside down. The next explosion of industry might not happen in a giant factory owned by a huge company. It will happen in your garage. Unless, of course, you're mainly using it to store old comic books. In that case, it might happen in the one next door.
When I was growing up, my dad and grandpa were always building something, always. I wanted to be there. And so as a kid, I was always working on something in my garage. And honestly, I got made fun of a lot, actually. yeah, they like to poke at me and stuff. Oh, that's a dumb idea. Like, you can never do that all the time. And I always wanted to prove him wrong. My dad always used to tell me, Shane, if you start something, make sure you finish it. That's what we did. Kind of one thing led to another, and we did some really, really cool stuff together. And when we started NiFT, Austin and Brandon, my two oldest sons, they said, hey, we're gonna quit our jobs. I was kind of upset at them actually at first, but they did. I'm really super thankful because I couldn't have done what we did together.
So picture a scenario where the ability to start a hardware company won't just be in the hands of those with easy access to venture capital. It'll be truly democratized. Well, that scenario is already mostly here. You can 3D print, run a CNC machine, cut with a laser, make your own circuit boards, hell, splice some jeans while you're at it. And you can do this all in your own home for a few hundred dollars in most cases. And it's only going to get cheaper and easier to do these things.
These are all tools to be able to do things faster, better. Just enjoy the challenge of making something that doesn't exist yet.
Of course, easier is not the same as easy. Doing something new is rarely easy at all, and no one knows that better than Shane.
I'm still learning, and I'm learning more aggressively now.
The shuttle was a big investment. The Lotus was a big investment. Then the drone is the start of a big investment. So that's been a huge, like, leap of faith.
It's one thing to say they built this car in 100 days, but they could only do that because of the years of experience and knowledge that they already had on day one.
Dad always took time to, like, build stuff with us, help us build things. He's got a lot of experience in the automotive field, and we get to start with those things rather than having to create them on our own. It's a cool thing getting to work with my dad, my brother. Not always easy. We've had lots of disagreements, for sure. But it also has been like, this is a good thing, because when we get through this, we'll be a lot stronger because of it.
The story of how inventions like this get made always starts much earlier than it might seem. Sometimes they go back years, or decades, or generations. But that story always tells us the same thing. If you have the temperament and willingness to learn and try, and then try again, then you get to build the future.